Very transformative. Yeah. Yes, it sparks some stuff very deep inside us. It facilitates change. It promotes growth. I think it does affect our DNA. It's a very deep thing. We have a relationship with the sun in that our DNA is, if we were to put together aggregate length of our entire DNA of the average human, it's 12.5 billion miles of the stuff. Oh. And that matches the length, the radius at which the sun projects its light before it's stopped by interstellar space and its heliosphere. So the magnetic field of the Earth,
yes,
is being pushed against by the magnetic field of the sun, and the magnetic field of interstellar space is pushing against the magnetic field of the sun in total. So we have this as a grouping, as a solar system, we're kind of like this electric dynamo that's in a process of rotation. So as we are rotating, there is this tail, if you will, that narrows down and curlicues out, that's trailing behind our solar system as we dolphin through this galaxy. And every time we hit these light quotients, these solar flares, it resets the dynamo of the whole energetic, of the whole electrical body of the solar system itself.
So it sounds like we really have some electrical charges that are affecting us from these solar flares. That's what it sounds like to me. And I know for one, and I've heard this from many many people I've spoke to, that you feel this sort of like pain. I get this pain in the side of my head, or different weird unanswerable things going on, and I feel like there's some type of change happening within me. And so that's been one of the big talks, things that people have been talking about. So have you had those sort of effects as well?
Yeah, it's bodily inflammations. I have, inflammation issues with this vehicle. And it always sparks up headaches. I get hit with headaches more readily during this period.
Peter, I'm coming back here with the sun flares. What does it mean when you talk about the sun as a water maker?
Recent discoveries made by the astrophysics community has found that the star system, or the nebula of Orion,
mm-hmm.
The Orion constellation that we see out in the skies in the winter up here.
Yeah.
That's the middle star of the three stars of Orion's belt is the Orion Nebula, and they've been looking at this with telescopes for some time, but they finally through spectrography they were able to get the right spectrum for determining H2O, the presence of that, and with their telescopes determined that within the Orion Nebula there was water being produced at a rate of 60 Earth oceans every half hour.
Whoa.
And as well, there's another galaxy that they found with a black hole at the center of it, that in a lower image, it's a graphic rendition of this, where there's water being ejected out of a black hole, just being produced at level, tremendous levels, far beyond the Orion Nebula, of producing water. So what this, this is, to me, it's always been this great mystery. Where did water come from? Half the planet is water, So
right.
it appears to be just some stuff that's in space. That's a product of the sun. So a nebula is an exploded sun that's now coalescing back into a organized star system. So, for instance, our sun used to be a nebula, and that coalesced over time and separated all the various elements, and two of those elements being hydrogen and oxygen. Now, this encodement of of the bonding sequence that we see in this image shows how the angle of 104.5 degrees at which the hydrogen attaches to the oxygen generate the three primary sacred geometries upon which all form is based. So there's this kind of there's a geometry for life that's carried along with the substance of life, which is water, and it's all activated by the sun. So the sun activates photosynthesis, makes bonds. Bonds DNA, which is memory and coding, into water, which is substance and form, and then it hangs off of this kind of fabric in space, which is gravity. And I think that's what we're seeing in these Earth ring forms is how gravity coalesces, and it's kind of not knowing for sure if that's the case, to make sure, you would say, it's the fingerprint of God. What we're looking at with these geometries is the intelligence of the Creator coming through and manifesting itself on multiple levels. Stars, we say, well, what's the, scientists say, well, Venus is too far away for its magnetic field to affect us at all. But if you look at Venus as being a resonant form that is nested within the Earth in the shape of its mantle, then you have a very intimate relationship between human, planet, and Earth in this co-creative dance. So it's this. Astrology would be kind of like, or geography would be just looking at the patterning of the universe and seeing how that all is shaking down. It's kind of this incredible intelligent machine that's at work out there with all these gears and points and energy. Where should we go from there, Andrea?
Well, what you're explaining though makes a lot of sense when you talked about the how everything is coalesce, how it works together, and what it produces. And you were talking about the sun as a water maker. I never ever knew what you just brought forward, that the sun has such an important part in. Making the
right.
water and its connection, its association, so on. Like
right. It is. So the sun and the entire solar system and water is all part of the same biology. It's a solar system biology that's spinning through space, rotating through space. It's almost as if that the sun itself is the core of a dynamo, and the spinning planets around it are what gives it its light, its sun, its spark. And so every so often it has to reset its spark, and that's the sunspot that gets hit, and that pulses out. The sun actually has like a rotational field, a curved arms, I think five arms of electric jets and whirls going around it, and we're caught in this spinning field of the sun. The sun rotates, and as it rotates, it's spinning off all this electrical discharge, and when it gets to a